Oh, yes, dear viewers. I am a crazy person. All these people are posting their top 10 anime of the year videos, or they did like 2 months ago when I originally wrote this part of the script, so you might have thought that I would do something kind of like that, but that would just be a bit too simple. I've decided to go all out with this video, and I have no idea how long this will take to record or edit. Probably a while, and me editing this video is probably going to want to hurt to me that came up with this idea like 6 months ago, but he'll just have to deal with it. And I hope that the neighbors don't mind them yelling at a microphone for like an hour, or ever how long this is. Yeah, the script is currently 9,318 words. Yay! So in this list, I have decided to include every anime from this year that I've at least tried, because some of these I only lasted an episode for. And yes, I know what you're saying, I could only include the animes that I liked that I thought were worthy of a top list, but why do that when I can make a top 100 list instead? This sounds like more fun. So a little bit of information how I'm doing this. I'm basically going to rank the shows that I completed all above the shows that I did not complete. I admit this might not be the best way to do it because I'm basically saying that Super Lovers is a better show than Kabunori, but I find it hard to compare the shows where I've seen everything to the shows where I've only seen part of it. Plus, I figure if I made it through the entire show, there's at least something in there that kept me interested that the ones I dropped did not have. Even if part of the reason I kept watching some of these shows was just because of how bad they were, so I guess that kind of counts for something in a weird, twisted way or whatever. I'm also ranking the shows I dropped based off how many episodes I got through by the same logic. Also, don't expect too much detail for shows at the bottom. I'll save detailed reasons for the top ones, though. And if, for whatever strange reason, you don't want to watch the entire video, because I don't know why anyone wouldn't want to watch me ramble for like 45 minutes or however long this will take, I will put some timestamps or annotations here so you can go click to the parts so you can see me and talk about the top 10 or whatever, assuming I can figure out the annotations. And because this is also going to vid me and they don't have them, you'll just have to go with timestamps, which I hope they actually have working. I don't know, we'll have to find that out. Vid me, you should add those if you don't have them already. Alright, let's do this. Number 100, Angverg. This show really earned its place at the bottom of the list by having a 10-minute scene of nothing but censored fan service. So, easily drop. Number 99, Kokaku no Pandora, a boring sci-fi show with lolly robot fan service. Number 98, Musekin no Phantom World, a slightly less boring fantasy with a nonsensical world and non-needed fan service. Number 97, Regalia the Three Sacred Stars, a boring show about mechs, I think. I actually am not entirely sure because it's been a while. Number 96, Tiger Mask W, a boring show about wrestling. It tried to be over the top with its action and plot, but this didn't connect to me at all, so dropped it after an episode. Number 95, Shazwar Zen Marken? I hope that's close to how you pronounce it. Anyway, a boring show about giant bugs and an alternate history or something. I got kind of lost with the first episode, and again, it's been a while. Number 94, Ajuku Mahai no Bahamut, a boring high school fantasy show with a cliche-shaped plot and unneeded fan service. Number 93, Aono Katana no Four Rhythm, a boring show about high school where there's a sport about people flying. The flying part is cool, but the rest of it was boring and cliche. Number 92, Nagashi Kashi, a boring show about a family who sells sweets and an annoying girl who makes life exciting or something. Number 91, Kumamiko, a boring show about a bear and a girl. Number 90, Bakan with 2 exclamation points, a boring show about cute girls doing cute motorcycle things and unfunny comedy. Number 89, And Happy with the Music Side, a show about cute girls having bad things happen to them, and not in the Higurashi sense of the word, so it's boring. Number 88, Panda Peace, a boring show about boring characters eating boring bread. And I like bread, so I'm disappointed. Number 87, Sancho Sayu, another boring show about cute girls doing cute things. There are those that say this has a bit more substance to it than others like it, and while this may be true, it didn't do anything to grab me, so here it's 87. Number 86, Sacred Rider Zex... I have no idea how to pronounce it, or Zex? Yeah, we'll go Zex. A boring show about, I don't even know. I think there's music and aliens involved, but I don't remember much of this one. I just remember that it was boring and I dropped it. Number 85, Amanshu, a painfully boring show about girls living near the sea. Some claim this is a relaxing show that's just so wonderful, but they are not me. Number 84, B Project, a boring show about boy bands. It might have turned into a reverse harem later on, but I'm not sure and I didn't get that far. Number 83, Endride, a boring show about a guy transported to another world where he meets a prince there. I was surprised at how this concept just completely failed to grab me. Number 82, Sensen Cerebus Ryoku no Fateles, or whatever. A mostly dull fantasy. I did kind of like the main character, but something tells me that if I kept going, I would lose interest pretty fast. Number 81, Token Rambu Hanamaru, a show about living swords traveling through time. Some interesting concepts maybe, but way too many characters for me to care about any of them, and not enough of a plot to make me keep going. Number 80, Mobile Suit Gundam Unicorn Re-0096, basically a dull Gundam show. It doesn't help that I didn't know the franchise that well, but I'm pretty sure this is a bad place to start. Number 79, Time Bokum 24, And this is a kid's show about time travelers. Kind of fun for what it was, but nothing to make me want to see more. Number 78, Norn 9, Norn plus Nonette. This is a reverse harem adventure show, and the first episode kind of got my attention, but not enough to make me keep going, and no one has talked about it since it aired, so I don't think I missed all that much. Number 77, Berserk 2016. Well, I might have more to say if I actually watched the old version of the show, but as it was a mildly interesting show with bad CG, being, yeah, a bad place to start the series. Number 76, Princess Stride Alternative. And this is a show about a running sport, and sports normally aren't my thing, and this one is no exception, so yeah. I won't call it bad, but not something I wanted to keep going with. Number 75, Fukigen no Mononoken. And this is a slice of life about spirits, and did not have a bad first episode, but it looks to be an episodic show, which I really don't care for, and they're just slice of life with a little bit of spirits, so I stopped out of the first episode. As something relaxing to watch, it works, but other shows do this better. Number 74, The Art Club Has a Problem. This was a cute romance story about characters in an art club. Again, not a bad first episode, and it might be decent, but this isn't a genre I'm really into, and there are others that do it better, so yeah, dropped it after one episode. Number 73, New Game with One Exclamation Point. Again, not a bad first episode, though I think part of the reason I liked it was how relatable it was, but for a slice of life, there wasn't enough to make me keep going, and most shows like this just get less interesting as they go on, even when the first episode wasn't all that interesting to begin with. Plus, from what I've heard, it doesn't do anything out of the ordinary later on, so yeah. I didn't feel there's a reason for me to keep going. It is better than the other shows that I dropped after one episode, for whatever that's worth. And now number 72, Isetta the Last Witch. This was one of the shows that I could see the appeal of, but didn't really grab me the way that I'd hoped. Plus, the community seemed to say it went downhill, so I never watched more than the first episode. Number 73, First Love Monster. A romance I was going places I didn't want to have anything to do with, and the humor was cringe, so no. Number 70, Days. From what I saw, it appeared to be a typical and therefore a boring sports anime, and with sports, I need something more than just the game itself to draw me in. And while the concept of an underdog practicing really hard to be the best is a concept that I like in theory, I found it to be overly cliche here and didn't care about it. Number 69, Divine Gate, a dull show about teenagers with superpowers. I did kind of like the first episode, but the second I just didn't care about what was going on, so I decided to drop it here. Number 68, Luck and Logic. The first episode made the show seem like it could be a different type of teenager with superpowers action show with the main character not wanting to fight anymore, but then it became a harem with an OP protagonist, so no. Number 67, Bubuki Baranki. And there are a lot of interesting questions raised in the first scene, but then I just stopped caring by the time the second episode came along and dropped the show. Number 66, Joker Game. Interesting concepts with the whole idea of spies and things, and then the second episode was boring and I heard it was just episodic, so dropped it. Number 65, Battery. A baseball anime that seemed like it could have some interesting drama elements to it, and then it became overly melodramatic in the second episode, and I just didn't like it at all then. Number 64, Hitori no Shita, The Outcast. From the trailer, it looked like it could be a cool show about zombies and superpowers, and then it just became a dull show with annoying characters by the end of the second episode. Number 63, Flying Witch. This is a show that I can appreciate for the calm, tranquil feeling it provides, and it's just not a feeling that I really care for. If I want to relax, I go for something that's more of a lighthearted comedy than Flying Witch was just calm and relaxing. Number 62, Tanaka is Always Listless, which is a slightly different comedy about a guy named Tanaka who likes being lazy. It's another one good to relax to, and the comedy is different, but the show is just so lacking in energy, it's not something I want to watch. I get that that's kind of the point of the show, so some might like it, it's just not for me. Number 61, Sweetness and Lightning. Again, similar to these last two, it's a cute show that has its appeal, and I can appreciate the appeal, but I need something more than what it offers for me to get into it. Number 60, Alderman of the Sea. And this is a show that did have some interesting moments, but it felt like a lot of it was just dull, and this is kind of disappointing despite the whole military part. Maybe worth a try, but I did not feel like it would be one that would be worthwhile for me. Number 59, Tsuki Uta, the Animation. This idol show originally got my interest by focusing on the brother of a fan of the group, but then the second episode moved away from that to be more of a drama show that I didn't care for and looked like it would be just like episodic plots, so no. Number 58, Time Travel Shoujo. This one is a lighthearted time travel show, which is not a bad concept. It has a heavy focus on teaching the viewer about science, which, again, not a bad thing. But a show has to tell an interesting story, and it seemed like it was trying to bash us over the head with the whole science part, and that just got in the way of the story. Maybe good for younger viewers who want to learn about scientists or something, but that's not me. Number 57, Poco's Udon World. This is another slice of life anime that follows a man as he travels back home after his father's death to find Poco, a child inside his father's udon shop. This is a bit more plot focused than the other slice of life anime I've talked about, but again, nothing to make me want to keep watching it. Not bad for fans of slice of life, and if you like slice of life, I recommend it actually, but I'm not one of these fans. So, not a show for me. Number 56, Kuro no Kuro. This is another example of a show that might be good for fans of the genre, but I'm not a fan of mechs. It is a mech anime where invaders come, this girl who had more time, and a samurai from the past have to team up to save the world. Yeah, I know, not a great description, and as I said, the show is not bad, and there's some excitement, some mystery, but I still found the show to be overall dull, so drop it after 2 episodes. Number 55, Showa Genroku Rakugo Shinju. This is a mature, unique story that breaks away from what we expect from anime, and it was also completely boring. I ended up dropping it after 2 episodes originally, but then everyone said how good it was, so I gave it another try, and then dropped it again after the 3rd episode. The 1st episode had a decent setup with the main guy getting out of jail and wanting to learn Rakugo from a Rakugo performer he admired. But the show seemed to put that plot on the side to instead tell the teacher's story, which suffered from pacing problems by having massive time skips, making it hard to get into the plot. It also suffered from using flashbacks so much when these weren't characters I cared about. And yeah, the show might be mature and different, but it takes more than that for me to call it a good show. Number 54, Haruchika. This is a show about a romance between 2 high schoolers, and they were interesting enough characters to make me like the 1st episode, but then turned to focus more on episodic plots, which were less exciting, and so the show just lost my interest. And yeah, it is pretty hard for a slice of life to be able to get me to care about it. Number 53, Nanbaka. Nanbaka was a show where it looked like it would be a fun, absurd comedy, and it was for the 1st episode, but then the jokes got duller and it just became a boring comedy after a few episodes. Number 52, Drifters. This is a show that had a lot of potential, but it suffered from a lot of characters that I didn't care about, along with comedy that just ruined the seriousness of key scenes. By the 4th episode, I did start to get interest in the story, and there were some cool characters I liked watching, plus the action was great, but the comedy just made the whole show fall apart, which really is a shame. One of the things anime is great at is dark and gritty action, but sadly, Drifters wasn't able to make this work. Number 51, 12 Sai. Now we are almost to the type of slice of life shows I like. This was a cute and innocent romance story, which I did like at first. Unfortunately, it's a type of show that's really easy to get bored with, so a few episodes in, I was wondering why I was watching it. Again, might be good for fans of the genre, but I need something a bit more. Number 50, 100. This is a mostly typical action harem light novel adaptation that I'm surprised I got as far as I did. There are a couple surprises early on which made me think that it could be good, or at least different, but really, this does seem like a show I'd seen 100 times before. Number 49, Active Raid. I end up having hopes that Active Raid could be a show that could embrace its stupid story and do it well, and it certainly had some moments where that appeared to be what the show is aiming for. Unfortunately, these were just too few to make up for the rest of the show just being dull and boring. The studio should really just stop trying to do all these new things and instead just make a new season of Twin Tales. Yes, I had to get that reference in at some point. Number 48, Nurse Witch Kogami-chan R. This is a show that I really loved at the start for its way of parody magical girl shows, but unfortunately comedy came wore off quick and that happened here. So we instead got a boring magical girl show that tried to be funny and tell an actual story and really failed at both of those. Number 47, Girls Beyond the Wasteland. This is another show that really got my attention at first with a group of characters making a video game. And the thing that really stood out to me was the creative process and the challenges that went along with it, something that relates to me quite well. Sadly, this is only a small part of the show as the rest seem to be just your typical boring slice of life. And yes, there are a couple slice of life shows I don't find boring, just not that many. We'll get to those later on. Number 46, Shoushin Shoujo Matoi. And here we have a typical, though slightly darker, magical girl show, and there were a lot of exciting parts near the beginning. Though as the show got further along, it seemed to forget about the whole action and danger part, and then instead just became far duller than I hoped. Maybe I should have just stuck it out since I got this far, and hoped that would get better, because maybe it did, but well. If you finish the show and think I should continue it, let me know, and there's a good chance I will. Number 45, Kabunari of the Iron Fortress. This is the show where I was blown away by the 1st episode, but sadly, my love of the show did not last long. While the action was done well throughout the story, I found to be increasingly dull and made the characters just annoying instead of people I wanted to root for. That and I found I could not get pulled into the final arc at all, so I just decided to drop it. Plus the whole concept of Kabunari, I felt hurt the show more than it helped because it would have been better if it was just like these normal people trying to fight against the zombies, but no, they couldn't go that way. And for the last of the drop shows, we have Concrete Revolution. Outside of long-running shows, I think this is the farthest that I've gotten on the show before dropping it. The 1st season brought so many different ideas together, and it created an interesting world with the different timelines did a good job of enhancing suspense, and the show really did explore the idea of being a hero. But as the show got further along, its constant introduction of new characters just became really tiring, as it felt like the overall plot wasn't going anywhere. The 2nd season ended up feeling episodic after a while, not giving us the answers that I had been hoping for since the beginning. It really is a shame that the show went downhill like this. There were a lot of really neat ideas that the show had going on at the start, but I just stopped caring about it during the 2nd season. And yeah, that's all those shows I dropped from the year. Yes, that was a lot. And now I need to go and I will record part 2 of this later. And now we move on to the category shows that I would want to finish, but I can't because I cannot find any more of the shows. And the one and only entry here, coming in at number 43 on my list, is Pei 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 Penguin. This show is cute and surprisingly funny. It's a short for kids about penguins, and I could only find the first episode, and that was raw, so I watched it anyway. And yeah, I don't know what they were saying, but it made me laugh, so yay? Yeah, there you go. Tell me if you can find more of this because I want to watch it, and preferably subbed or dubbed, so I kind of doubt the last one. So, now we move on to the category of shows that I actually completed. And coming in at number 42 on the list, we have Big Order. And while the placement of this show should not come as any surprise to anyone who saw this show or saw my review of it, but looking back, I think I might have been a little bit too harsh on the show, because it does one thing right, and that is be a terrible anime. I dropped a lot of anime, 57 if you're counting, because it lost my interest, but Big Order kept me watching with its ever-growing amount of failure, which is an accomplishment in some sort of weird way. It truly earned its spot on the list as the worst show that I completed, and for that, it gets some praise in a strange way. Plus, I already said all the bad things about it in my review, so go watch that if you want me to rant about the show. For now, I'm actually praising it for the one and only time in my lifetime. Number 41, Super Lovers. It might surprise you that I actually had a little bit of hope that this would be a good show. The reason I had this hope was because I thought it would be absolutely hilarious if it ended up being a great show because of how mocked it was before it aired. And it did have a little bit of potential. It was telling the story about these two brothers, and it could show them growing close together, deal with life, especially with the life that Ren had. And there was a lot of backstory that could have been fleshed out. Unfortunately, we got a little of this, but instead it was mostly just romance that seemed to go nowhere, along with Ren's character development and characters that really didn't add anything to the show, so yeah. It actually felt like they were just taking bits and pieces out of the manga, and that just made the show itself feel disjointed. And then the incest ruined it for me, though I guess I can't really blame it when it advertised itself as incest, but still, I don't like it. Number 40, Seku Boys. I'd like to say that this anime rocks because I like bad puns, but sadly that isn't the case. This short is a comedy about this idol group who are stone statues, and the show draws its strength from the absurdity of the fact that the main characters are statues. While the show was fun at first, it didn't last that long since the comedy is rather one note and there really wasn't a plot to drive the story forward, so I lost interest pretty quickly. I was still able to finish it, but yeah, nothing that great here. Number 39, Taboo Tattoo. Taboo Tattoo is one of the shows that is just dumb action and you're not supposed to think about much, and while that's not a sign of a great anime, it can still be enjoyable if it's done right. Because of this, I liked Taboo Tattoo for a while. There was exciting conflict, likable enough characters, and some things about becoming a hero of justice. Plus, there was a twist I really liked about halfway through it because it was just not something I expected, and I was glad to see that it happened. I also enjoyed laughing at the stereotypes that they gave the American soldiers, but unfortunately the show ended up being even more convoluted mess by the end, and the show was also left unfinished. Not a bad show if you like a dumb action, but you can do a lot better. And this is far from the last time I'm going to complain about a show being incomplete. Number 38, Fate Grand Order. One of these days, I'll understand how the 13 million series that make up the Fate franchise all connect, but I don't think that'll be anytime soon. This entry in the franchise takes place in the future with the characters traveling back in time to the Holy Grail Wars to save the world or something. I did like some of the action here, and trying to figure out what was going on was interesting, especially since they had some familiar characters, though they were different than we were used to seeing them. But unfortunately, the plot really wasn't all that well explained, and I don't know if this is just like an advertisement to advertise the game or whatever this is based off of, or if we'll actually get more of the story. I hope we do, but even then, comparing it to the first episodes of Fate Zero and Fate Stay Night Unlimited Blade Works, I didn't find this one to be as good. Maybe I'll like it once we see more, though. Number 37, And You Thought There Was Never a Girl Online. This is a show that I thought could be really good because I'm a big fan of MMOs, so I was interested in seeing an anime about how the friendship formed in these games could grow in and outside of the game. Unfortunately, it did not live up to my hopes. There were a few good parts that show the value that these games had and also showing the danger of using them as an escape from society, but I found the show to be relatively shallow and the believability that could have made it interesting just wasn't there, especially in the later episodes. I hope that this is not the last show that explores video games in this way, as I think it could make a great anime, but this one did not. Number 36, Yuri on Ice. When it came to popularity this year, Yuri on Ice was certainly near the top. This show about ice skating was able to capitalize on this fan service to reach a broad audience, which had many people say it was an anime that made history, though I am not one of those people, for reasons that I want to get into in a separate video. There were some interesting things here, such as Yuri trying to follow his dreams while dealing with anxiety, but I found the skating routines got old after a while, and when the show was so much just character skating, well, that's not a good thing. There was some interesting drama between some of the characters, but again, nothing all that great, and I felt that the romance that the show ended up becoming known for had a lot to be desired. Plus, it's unfinished. If a show really wanted to make history, it should actually finish up its story without us having to wait for a season 2 that may or may not ever come. On a positive note, it did make me want to adopt a fluffy dog, so I guess that's a good thing. Or I just like fluffy animals. I mean, who doesn't like fluffy animals? Number 35, Orange. Orange was a show that I was excited for, considering the manga is so well-liked, and from the start, the show appeared like it would be an interesting drama focusing on the themes of regret and wanting to change one's life, with the main character receiving a letter from herself in the future. The show had a lot of emotionally powerful moments, and I loved seeing the friendship between the different characters, and then the show had enough good plot twists to keep the whole thing exciting. I also loved how the show handled depression here, and how powerless it can feel to fight it for those who are suffering from it and those who want to help. Unfortunately, the show relied so much on the plot twists that when they weren't present, the show just felt dull. But really, the worst thing about the show was the reveal of how the letters were able to travel through time, and because this ruined the show's believability, which is what so much of the drama was built off of. I know I shouldn't expect perfect logic for anything involving time travel, but the explanation here felt like it just came out of big order, which unfortunately brought Orange down quite a bit. Number 34, Real Life. Real Life was a show that I don't think got the attention it deserved, considering it was a show that was released all at once instead of in weekly episodes. I do wonder if more anime will be released this way, because most of the anime on this list I watched after they had aired, and I watched them all within a span of about a week. Well, a week per anime, not a week for 100 anime, because that would be crazy, and not even I am that crazy. Anyway, this is mostly a slice of life, but the concept of an older guy seeing high school again did make it stand out at times. It took a little while to really grab my attention, and it teased a second season, which again, we haven't heard anything about, so I can't really recommend it. Decent at best, but I wouldn't consider it anything more. Number 33, Glass no Hana to Kawasu Sekai. This is a movie that stands out more so for its concept than its execution. It tells the story of these two girls who are computer programs whose job it is to protect data about the world from being destroyed through viruses, and as would be expected from a show like this, we learn what really happened to the world and what the girls' true mission is throughout the show. Well, that and these girls are as moody and cute and everything, which is really like half the appeal of the show. It's been a while, but I do remember enjoying the story as it unfolded, though it is one that's best not think too much about, otherwise you'll probably find lots of plot holes. But on the plus side, the animation looked cool, so yeah, not something I have a lot of praise for, but it was okay. Number 32, Chiranachi. I really enjoy anime that challenges stereotypes, and while this is typically seen through a show breaking with conventions of storytelling, Chiranachi takes another path by telling the story of a men's cheerleading team. From the very beginning, it sought to stand out by confronting the stereotype that cheerleading isn't for guys, while also illustrating the power of encouragement that something like cheerleading can offer. The show also touches on the challenges of being in a sports team like this, when some people just want to have some fun, others want to win competitions, and everything in between. There's also the difficulty in committing to a hobby like this, when more commitments are focused upon these young adults, such as school or work, and all these concepts make Chiranachi the most ambitious sports anime I've seen. Unfortunately, it wasn't able to capitalize on these ideas. The show felt oversaturated with all the characters when few of them got the development that they needed, and the animation really wasn't able to capture the hype that the practice and competitions needed for a sports show to be good. The story did have some good points, but also felt boring due to me not caring about a lot of the characters, so sadly I can only say it was an average show. Number 31, Quality of Code. It seems like every season there is a light novel adaptation, which is about a school for teenagers with superpowers, and then we have an overpowered protagonist who gets a harem. And Quality of Code certainly seemed to be as generic as the rest at first, but there is a hint early on that there is something more, and it ended up having several good surprises throughout. The show did a good job of having enough twists to keep the show interesting, and definitely tried to be a show that rose above the many generic anime out there. Unfortunately, it wasn't able to deliver on anything that different, since beyond the twist, it's a mostly generic show, and the animation was certainly lacking during the later battles. The music was quite standout though, which helped with the emotional impact of these later scenes. Overall, not a bad show, but again, not much more than average. Number 30, Ajin. Ajin is a show about the possibly overdone trope of a main character who finds out he is some sort of supernatural being, in this case, an immortal Ajin. So he has to run for his life. There are a lot of things I really like about Ajin, such as the way they really hone on in K's fear of being captured and his desperation to get away. K is also a unique protagonist, as he's much more interested in helping himself than worrying about others around him, and he sees his companions as a mere means to an end, and this makes him interesting to watch. But of course, the villain Sato steals the spotlight. He is ruthless, cunning, evil, but he's a character that you'd love to see win. Unfortunately, the second season went downhill, with it spending a lot of time to build up on a big battle against Sato, instead of focusing on Kay's struggle to stay free, which made the first season so great. They also introduced a new villain who just felt cheesy compared to Sato, and to top it all off, it ended with a cliffhanger for season 3. There's a lot to like about Ajin, but I really can't recommend a show unless it has a conclusive end. Number 29, Sushi Police. A show about a police force that attempts to stop counterfeit sushi seems like a stupid idea, and the short anime seems to agree. Each episode was only a few minutes long and was enjoyable to watch because it is a simple show that knows that the concept is stupid, but runs with it anyway. There's also some decent growth for the main character, and it does leave a strong message with the viewer. Again, not all that great, but short and fun, so I'll take it. Number 28, Dimension W. This is an example of a cool action show with interesting characters and an interesting setting, and then you have these characters trying to insert sharp objects into each other. It doesn't take a lot for me to get into a show like this, and the action center plotline was blended nicely with the mystery of Kyoma's past. There were some issues I had with the show, such as the science fiction elements not really making that much sense if you thought about it, and there were also some dull points near the middle. But still, it was a show I enjoyed, even if it's not one I can strongly recommend. Number 27, Haven't You Heard I'm Sakamoto? Put an overpowered protagonist in a slice of a comedy and you get Sakamoto. The comedy draws its strength from how Sakamoto is able to figure out the best solution to every problem and improve his classmates' lives in ways that only he can. The show is a master of the unexpected, and you may know that he'll find a way out of the situation, but it's always a surprise when you see how he ends up doing it. The show also spent a good deal of time fleshing out its side cast too. Unfortunately, the comedy could be hit or miss, and with a lot of times the episodes were building up to a single punchline, then when the comedy didn't work, the whole episode so it just fell flat. Overall, it's a pretty good comedy with some life lessons that could only be taught by Sakamoto. Number 26, High School Fleet. Cute girls doing cute naval warfare things may seem like a concept that couldn't possibly be good, but much to my surprise, I ended up liking the show. While much of it was basic, the battles between the ships and the various conflicts were done well, and the main character Misaki did grow a good amount throughout the series. I still like the more lighthearted moments as they served to contrast the serious plot that the show sometimes had. If you like moe shows that offer a touch of seriousness to them, this is one you'll probably enjoy, and I have to say it has the best naval warfare battles in any anime I've ever seen. Granted, I've only seen like two of those. But still, not a bad show. Number 25, Erased. I'm a fan of time travel shows along with suspense shows, so combine these together and it's not surprising that I like Erased. I really love seeing Sato and his friends try to outsmart the villain of the show, and there are a lot of really powerful moments either through suspense or sadness or just heartwarming scenes. Sadly, the show could not keep up its strong start, as once the show got closer to the end, the finale felt quite unfulfilling. Not to mention the whole time travel thing seemed to be more of a plot device than actually being explained. Still, when the show was good, it was amazing, and that was enough for it to outweigh the issues I had with it. Number 24, Occultic 9. Occultic 9 is a supernatural mystery show that knows how to keep me at the edge of my seat. Yuta is a high school student who runs a blog about the supernatural, and he finds himself involved in a murder of a professor and then connected to a mass suicide where hundreds of people just walked into a lake and drowned. What follows is a story where Yuta and his companions slowly unravel the truth about what happened. The show does a wonderful job of showing the characters dealing with the situation they find themselves in, and the plot twist made the show constantly exciting. Unfortunately, the unique style of the show ended up hurting it more than anything, with the visuals distracting me from the actual story. The ending also felt like it tied everything up overly easy, which really cheapened everything else the characters have been through. This is still a show I liked, but it felt like it could have been one that I would have liked a lot more. Number 23, Grimgar of Fantasy and Ash. This is the show that restored my faith in the trapped in a video game. It takes a more realistic look at the situation as the main characters are quite weak at the beginning of the show, so we can really see them grow more powerful throughout it. I also really like the character drama and seeing how all the different characters reacted to the situation that they were in. It also had a very unique art style and one of the best soundtracks of the year, making it really stand out. And it did have some of the most powerful emotional moments in the entire year. There is a lot to love about Grimgar, but unfortunately I cannot rank it higher because of it being incomplete. I know it's not the first time you've heard me complain about this, nor will it be the last. Number 22, His Sim, Not Me. Yaoi fangirls scare me, you know who you are, and this show illustrates why. It's a parody of the reverse harem genre, with a heroine being adored by four guys. She's instead in love with the characters of her anime, and she'd rather ship the guys who like her with each other than date any of them. This does lead to some great comedy, though when the show's comedy is lacking, there isn't much more substance to the characters or story. I do admire the show for adding that one twist, though, and it did have some good parts with the different guys. Plus, it did have an ending that fit the show quite well, so that was a plus. Overall, not a bad comedy, but also not one I would consider remarkable. Number 21, Show by Rock Season 2. Show by Rock is one of the weirdest music anime I've seen, because yes, you have the whole idol thing with various bands, but it takes place in a fantasy world where music is power, and in this season you have aliens who want to invade, so the heroes must fight with the power of music. And yeah, you're not supposed to take this show seriously, and that's why it works. There's so much about the story that is absurd and stupid, which makes it fun. There's also a lot of time spent on the different characters and their friendship, which gives the show a good foundation. Plus, the art style is a really vibrant one. Unfortunately, the show did suffer from seeming to forget that it had a plot for a few episodes, but it eventually got back to the fun musical adventures. If you're looking for something fun with some cute girls playing music and saving the world, I think Show by Rock is the anime for you. Number 20, Shonen Maid. Yet another show I had the completely wrong idea about it coming in. I expected it to be a trashy fan service type show where a boy dresses as a maid to appeal to the fetishes of the community, but what I got was the complete opposite. Instead, I end up getting an incredibly heartwarming story about family where a young man named Ichihiro loses his mother so is instead taken in by his slightly eccentric uncle. This anime is all about the love that family has for each other and something that Ichihiro learns to experience. The show is great at making me smile, and really the only issue I had with it is that it kind of dragged on at times, but if you're looking for a relaxing slice of life show, this is one that I would suggest. Number 19, Kimi no Na wa. This movie certainly made a big impact on the community, setting so many records that I can't keep track of them. The movie had an interesting take on the romance genre, showing two characters grow close together despite their many differences, and I really did like the later half when the stakes started to rise for these characters. Combine this interesting story with great production values and, well, it's no wonder it was a hit. Sadly, I didn't feel like the movie lived up to the hype, with the romance feeling a bit rushed and the conclusion felt like it dragged on longer than it needed to. Not a bad movie by any means, but still one I found overrated. But then again, when people say it's the best anime ever made, yeah, it's not hard for me to find it overrated. Anyway, moving on. Number 18, Haikyuu. Haikyuu is easily one of my favorite sports anime, and while this normally isn't the genre for me, it's able to draw me in with the hype surrounding the game like no other. Throughout the anime, they focus on the different character conflicts and the desire to get stronger, with the training camp being the best part of the anime. The show demonstrates that following your dreams is a hard road, and that there are many setbacks along the way, but it's still a road worth traveling. Unfortunately, the tournament arcs became predictable, taking away some of the tension, and this is another incomplete show. I am expecting a season 4 at some point, but again, we're just left hanging for now. Number 17, Bungo Stray Dogs. Stray Dogs was a show that I was looking forward to and I thought it could be something great, but it took a while for me to really see where it was going. The show tells the story of a detective agency where the agency all have supernatural powers, with the main character being an orphan that they take in. The first season is mostly episodic as the cast is introduced with the Good Yellow Comedy thrown in. Not a bad show, but nothing all that great. Then the second season came and floored me with the quality of storytelling it offered. We see what makes the aloof Daizai the person that he was, and the tensions between the supernatural factions in the city erupts into a war, and the main character is forced to overcome the demons of his past. I love seeing all the pieces of the plot come together, the thrill of rooting for the heroes, and even sometimes the villains, and the final battle here is quite possibly the best battle of the entire year. The second season almost made this the contender for anime of the year, but just as it was about to wrap up amazingly, they ended up leaving us on a cliffhanger for season 3, so instead it goes down here. I really wish anime would stop doing this, but as you can see for the next few entries, I'm not going to get my hopes up anytime soon. Number 16, ReZero. There are some shows every year that have an insane amount of hype surrounding them, ReZero probably being the biggest one from this past year. And much to my surprise, the show actually lived up to the hype, if not surpassing it. It told an amazingly gripping story as Subaru is taken to a fantasy world, and he has to save the people he cares about while having time reset every time he dies, which happens quite a lot. The show really takes advantage of this concept by fleshing out the different characters and parts of the story through each time loop. I love the way they showed Subaru's character and how his foolish actions lead to so many problems, but also how he was able to learn and grow from his failures. When it comes to a story that pulled me in, none could compare to ReZero from this past year, and would easily deserve the place of one of my favorite anime of all time, but of course, it's unfinished, and no matter how much I enjoy what we got, I cannot consider a show that leaves so much up in the air a good show, so it goes down here. Number 15, Kizune Veer. This show is a fascinating melodrama telling the story of these high school students who have their pain linked. Through having their pain linked, they learn more about each other and what made each character the way that they were and the scars that they bear. The emotional power that the show packed was incredible. There's a lot of themes about friendship and the craving of the human heart to want companionship. While it did not have the lasting impact that would have put it higher on the list, it is another example of how Traeger is able to use the expectations the medium has set to do something different. And well, I hope they continue doing stuff like this for a long time to come. Number 14, Myogia. This is one of the shows that I really disagree with the anime community as a whole on. Pretty much everyone other than me seems to hate it, and well, I enjoyed it quite a lot. It's a weird mix of different genres telling the story of these people who want to run away, so they go to a mythical city where it turns out the demons of their past they cannot escape from quite so easily. There are a lot of different elements from different genres, from mystery to horror to romance, and it really comes together in an absurd but still fascinating way. I can see why people take issue with it, but it was still one that I really liked, and I have my whole review talking about why, even though I've decided to lower my score a little bit since making that review. But still, go check that out if you want my full opinion. Number 13, Space Patrol Lulico. Trigger really is one of my favorite anime studios because of how creative all their shows seem to be and how much fun they are to watch, and this one is certainly fun. It tells the story of Lulico, a normal girl, or more like a girl who wants to live a normal life, until she gets roped into joining the Space Patrol and must save her normal town from evil aliens. To say the show is absurd would be an understatement, and this did make it a lot of fun. What really stood out to me though is the universe that the show explored, with some surprising revelations reminding me of why I love Trigger so much. It also examined the ideal of a normal life and the foolishness of young love in a way that only anime can. This show is pure fan service for fans of Trigger's other works, and makes me hopeful for where they will go in the future. Number 12, Konosuba. The trapped in a video game genre has been done many times, but before this past year, I never expected much from the genre. But while Grimgar took a more serious look at how a story like that could work, Konosuba did the opposite, parodying all the cliches that the genre has to offer. The show probably has the best comedy of any anime itself for the year, and even while the humor did get repetitive at times, the situations that the characters managed to get themselves in were always hilarious. Unfortunately, there wasn't much of a plot, so the show kinda got boring when the comedy wasn't on point, and the characters were kinda flat, but this is still a really fun show, and if the second season can have some sort of plot progression while keeping up the comedy, I'll be quite happy. Number 11, Momokuri. Occasionally, I just want an anime that can make me smile and help me relax. Not often, but sometimes, and when I was in that mood, I found Momokuri to be the perfect anime. It is a simple romance between these high school students as they grow closer together. The characters all have their own issues which added to the comedy, and there is a touch of drama to keep the show interesting, but never too much. There isn't a whole lot to the show, but it's able to succeed through its simplicity, and that's what has made it my favorite anime romance of all time. Number 10, Magical Girl Raising Project. Maybe there is something wrong with me, but I do quite enjoy seeing cute anime girls violently kill each other. This is an anime that for a brief second might appear to be light and fluffy, but if you read the summary, you know that this show is going to be a dark magical girl show. Though I was actually surprised at how much blood and violence there was. The strength of this show is in the conflict between all the characters, the fact that you never know when one of them will die. Some of them are good people who just want to help others or be a hero of justice, while others just want power or others just want a good battle. The fights here are great, both from an animation perspective, but also through the mind games as each character tries to figure out how they can overcome their foe's power. I was also really impressed by one of the villains of the show, as she wasn't like any other villain I'd seen before. I can see why some might have issues with the show, and I'll admit many of the characters were underdeveloped, but with the exciting story and emotional power that the show had, this was one that I really enjoyed. Number 9, Keijo. Some of my favorite shows are those that remember anime is all about having fun. Sure, these grand adventures and heart-racing stories are amazing and all, but sometimes I just want something to make me laugh at the ridiculousness of it all, and Keijo delivers here amazingly well. You might think the idea of a sports anime where girls attack each other with their boobs and busts is stupid, but the show pushes this stupid concept so far that it goes so extreme that it becomes my favorite sports anime. In part, this is because the show gave me a satisfying ending without ever getting boring, and also because of how great the matches were to watch. I love seeing all the different abilities these girls had, and not just because the references that some of them involved. Action was amazing, hitting all the right notes to deliver on the hype, and you can't help but have fun at a show so ridiculous. The only reason that the show isn't higher on the list is because the only thing it offers is fun, not anything of substance, and I do like a little bit of substance to my absurd shows. Number 8, Mob Psycho 100. This is an anime that I wondered if it could live up to the hype it had going for it at the start, and well, it turned out as good as I had hoped. While I did like One Punch Man, it felt like it was an all-style, no-substance type of show, fun to watch, but not much of a gripping story. While Mob Psycho managed to tell a much more grounded story, focusing a decent amount on the interactions with Mob and those around him through the ordinary parts of his life. Despite Mob's incredible power, he's shown as not all that special to those he cares about, while at the same time humbling those who see him as better than everyone else. This is a show that constantly subverts expectations, both through the comedy and the serious parts of the show, and also serves as a counterpoint to all the other teenagers with superpower type shows. And then the animation is just simply incredible. I have said before that Bones is a master of stylized action, and they prove this even truer with Mob Psycho. Sadly, this is yet another incomplete show. I feel this is less detrimental to some of the other shows on the list because of how the message the show is telling teen to be tied up here, but still, you can tell there's more story to tell, and I hope they do tell it eventually. Number 7. To Be a Hero. Anime shorts really seem to be overlooked. Sure, many of them don't have much to them, but a simple comedy is better than a lot of the full-length shows that come out every year. And To Be a Hero is a gag comedy with a focus on toilet humor and just some very weird characters. The comedy is surprisingly good all throughout, utilizing the short episode lengths to just not get dull. But where the show really stands out and what sets it above all the other lighthearted comedies was the story that it had to offer behind all the absurd comedy. It also has one of the best final episodes of anything I've seen this year that not only wrapped up the story, but it enhanced everything that came before. Where the last 2 minutes just devolved to nonsense, but this is from the creative Excel saga, so I think you just need to turn your brain off for that part. Still, great comedy, surprisingly touching story, and probably my favorite anime short of all time. Number 6, Assassination Classroom. One of the things I love most about anime is how it's able to use absurd concepts to deliver a down-to-earth story, and Assassination Classroom is one of the best examples of this. The second season focused in on the cast that have been established, allowing them to learn and grow as they try killing their teacher, and learning the truth about Kuro Senshi led to some of the most emotional moments the show had to offer. The core of the show's strength is the message it has about how one person can make a difference in the world, and how those that are written off as worthless can do incredible things. I did have a few issues with the show, like how some of the ideas are handled and some plot points that don't make complete sense, but just like the students, my time spent with this class will be forever cherished. Number 5, flip-flappers. I don't even know where to begin describing this one, except to say that it is something really unique. It's about a girl who meets another girl, and they go on adventures becoming magical girls and explore this world called Pure Illusion, looking for these items that will grant their wish. And well, this show gets weird from there. Each episode, they explore a different world of Pure Illusion, and just the ideas that these different worlds present is really incredible. And there are a lot of messages about what it means to grow up and to find your place in the world. I ended up not liking it after a few episodes because it just felt like there was lots of these weird things happening, but there wasn't a story I could connect to. Though I'm glad I decided to give it another try, as there really were some great episodes in the middle, even though it still felt episodic at that time. But about two-thirds of the way through the show, we got a more continuous story, and then it all tied together, and, well, I just really liked what we got. So I'm glad I decided to give this one another try. Number 4, 91 Days. There are those who have said, I only like violent shows, and how much I like 91 Days does not disprove this argument. It tells a story of revenge taking place in the Prohibition-era America, which alone sets it apart from the vast majority of anime. The suspense was solid throughout the show, as Avila was trying to get close enough to the Mafia to exact his revenge, while also avoid being killed himself. This exciting plot, unique setting combined with the twist of morality the show portrayed made it one of my favorites of the year, and is one that I consider for the top spot, but there are a couple others that just barely got above it. Number 3, Survamp. I rarely have much hope for stories that involve vampires. Sure, there are some gripping stories about them throughout the ages, but things like Twilight and Diabolic Lovers have tainted their image for me, so I expected a bad romance with a touch of supernatural with Survamp. But much to my surprise, I got one of the best action shows of the year. The show tells the story of a group of vampires and the human masters, and if you've seen Fate, it's a similar concept of masters and servants. There are some incredible battles between the various vampires and masters. I also really like the main character. He has a desire to be a good person and to make a difference to the world, but his ideals were challenged by seeing everything that was happening around him, and he was far from the only interesting character. The show also had one of the best dubs that came out this year. Once again, though, this anime is incomplete, otherwise it would have been an Anime of the Year contender, but much to my surprise, we're actually getting a second season, which was just recently announced, hence the reason I decided to move this up to the number 3 spot. It might not be complete, but hopefully it will be eventually, and this announcement is giving me hope. Number 2, Boku no Hero Academia. My Hero Academia is a show that perfectly encapsulates what I love about the action shonen genre. Deku's journey to become a hero is an inspirational one, and I loved how it dove into what it means to be a hero. While there are parts of the show that are cliche, these are cliches that I love seeing, such as the inspiration of All Might or the rivalry between Deku and Katsuki. The battles do an amazing job of drawing me into them and trying to figure out along with the heroes how they're going to overcome these challenges, and the production values are some of the best the genre has to offer, and I cannot wait to see where the show will go from here. The long-running shonens are what got me into anime with things like Bleach, Naruto, and Fairy Tail, and Boku no Hero is a refinement of the formula that these shows established. It might not be overly groundbreaking, but it just channels everything that I love about these other shows, and this is why I give Boku no Hero the highest score of any anime from 2016. Though it is not at the top of my list because, like so many others, it is incomplete. Now we have a second season coming out soon, so I didn't lower the score I gave the show, but I still refuse to put an incomplete show at number 1. So we have finally reached the top of the list, so you might be wondering what it could possibly be. I fit all the popular choices like ReZero, Boku no Hero, Super Lovers, and so on. You're probably trying to figure out which show I missed. But well, at number 1, we have Girlish Number. Yes, I'm as surprised as everyone else that A Slice of Life is the top show of the year, and no, I did not just steal this from DigiBro, but I'm just slower at making these videos than he is. So if you don't know, Girlish Number is a show about anime voice actors, a concept that has been done before and done well, but where Girlish Number stands out is the cynical look at the industry it offers. The primary show these characters are working on is a bad light novel adaptation, and the main girl is a terrible voice actor and a terrible person more often than not. Then we have another one of the characters who is trying to deal with her family not accepting her decision to be a voice actor, while another feels like she's forced into her roles when she wants to be her own person. The reason both Slice of Life anime bore me is because there is not a conflict I care about, but there is so much in this one driven by these characters and their flaws. While sometimes admirable characters can be fun to watch and also inspiring, this anime offers more relatable characters that were really able to connect with me. What really made this show my number 1 of the year was how inspirational it managed to be, as the ending really focused on the idea of continuing to follow your dreams despite all your weaknesses and how messed up the world can be. It's one thing to have an inspirational story, but it's another thing to have an inspirational story be so realistic, and that's what made it really stand out to be one of my favorite anime of all time. So, we finally reached the end of the list, and I did not even want to see how long I've been recording this for. But yeah, it's over. I hope you enjoyed this video. I have had fun watching all these different anime. I'm sure there are some differences in opinions between us, because I'd be shocked if someone had the same 100 anime in this order as I do. But yeah, tell me what your thoughts on the year are. If you think there are any anime that I dropped too soon, or I just never checked out, tell me, and I might go back to it, though I kind of don't have anything more to do with 2016. Maybe I should go back to those other things. I don't know. So yeah, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it, and I will see you all next time. Holy crap, 49 minutes. Ah! Boy, this will be fun. I hope Tony doesn't crash.